And are there any introductions like to make before I get started?
Not a lot, because I don't want to waste your valuable time, knowing that it's limited, but I think it's absolutely wonderful to see so many people on this call to listen to your public presentation. And I'd like to congratulate Mark Anthony in advance for what I'm hoping will be a wonderful and successful defense in a little while. So welcome, everyone. I'm Anna Willow, Mark Anthony's advisor. I think his committee members are here. And he's going to present on his dissertation research, Changing Vidi Vini Cultures in Ohio, USA, and Alsace, France, an ethnographic study of terroir and the taste of place.
Awesome. Well, hello and bonjour, and thank you all for attending this virtual presentation of my dissertation project. And thanks, Anna, for the introduction. It's so great to see everyone who's from Ohio. I think we have some folks from Alsace and elsewhere. I'd like to just jump right in and start off by saying that if we talk about viticulture, we're talking about growing grapes. If we talk about viniculture, we're talking about making wine. But if we're talking about vitiviniculture, as I'll be doing today, we're talking about the totality of grape growing and the winemaking system. And so the title of my dissertation is a play on words. I'll be talking today not only about how parts of the vine to wine process is changing, but also how social and cultural processes are changing in my regions of study. I'll be presenting my dissertation in a sort of French memoir kind of way today, articulating how I've come to understand terroir and the taste of place among American and French wine growers. In short, wine growers or vignerons both grow their own grapes and sell wines they make from those grapes. I emphasize my use of this term as distinct from those who only produce grapes, viticulture, and those who solely focus on making wines, vintners. The terroir concept, which I shall discuss in the forthcoming slides, sits at the core of my work. As a bit of a spoiler, I aim to illustrate a conceptualization of terroir as a place-based social-ecological system comprised of actants whose relationships may be understood through the production and consumption of sensory stimuli. Or in simpler words, humans and non-humans are involved in the wine growing system and are linked in by the senses. As the final introductory thesis or thesis of my dissertation is the new framing of the taste of place as a system that allows us to understand how different components of the wine growing system interact in the midst of change. My dissertation is the culmination of 18 months of ongoing ethnographic fieldwork that I conducted in February 2018. Growing because our contact was informed and gracious in responding back and providing seasonal updates since the technical conclusion of my project at the tail end of summer 2019. It's a dissertation, which is composed of 4 published or in review articles, their book ended by an introduction that covers the background, theoretical framework, and methodological approaches that guided my data collection and analysis. Conclusion that aims to synthesize the article chapters and offer additional food for thought in terms of how I'm making work further. The article that initially inspired my work was this 2005 piece published by Eric Duchesne and Christophe Schneider, where they noted a recorded warming trend in Alsatian vineyards from the period of 1972 to 2002. In particular, this trend was concerning for the varietals pictured on the screen, Gewürztraminer. These are cool weather grapes that are sensitive to heat, which is the production of sugars and relative lack of acidity that yields a disequilibrium in taste. And so there's this question in my mind of how can we understand a sense of cultural stability or identity in the midst of dynamic change? What might it mean if Alsatians could no longer grow and produce Gewürztraminer or Riesling, which are very much endemic or linked to those areas if it got too hot? As I've shared with my students in the past, we could also ask a similar question of what might it mean for Ohio State if the state up north, or for some of you tuning in, that'd be Michigan, became the growing site for the highly symbolic Buckeye tree. Of course, culture is always changing, and there are adaptive responses that bring about a sense of continuity or even a new normal. In this process, what emerges are questions of identity that play out in at least 3 ways: among people, product, and place. What does change mean for those who produce and consume wine locally or regionally grown grapes? To what extent, if any, could we anticipate their continuation? And what does the space called Alsace or Ohio mean without these gastronomic symbols? Indeed, these regions provide 2 very different environments to think about grapes and wine. In a Levi-Straussian, they are indeed good to think with. So for an explanatory endpoint of how wines remain Alsatian or Ohioan while production and consumption processes are changing, I first asked 3 descriptive questions. What changes do wine growers perceive in their vineyards, wine cellars, and tasting rooms? As things are changing, how do they respond? And what does this all mean in terms of how wine growers understand tahor and the taste of place? Herein, I assume changes, something else responds or changes too, to the point that we can ask questions about changes to identity. With these questions in mind, I began my studies at home, conducting research in Central Ohio. This was largely due to logistical convenience, whereby the 6 research sites, signified by the red circles on your screen, that I visited a total of 46 times, were within an hour's drive one way of Ohio State or Dublin, where I currently live. Toward the start of my project, I was also fortunate to attend the 2018 Ohio Grape and Wine Conference, which conveniently happens to also take place in Dublin. Generally speaking, Central Ohio is relatively flat and contains about 3 to 4 soil types, with much of the region sitting on a glacier. In Alsace, I also considered how easy it would be to get to a given vineyard, as I heavily relied on my ability to bike or walk. My core sample is located in the bottom half of the region of Autre, and was composed of 3 wineries in the wine-growing capital city of Colmar, the winery of what was then known as the French National Institute for Agricultural Research, where it was based, and 2 wineries in the neighboring commune of Wittelsheim, all of which I visited a total of 21 times. On average, the biking or walking distance was no more than minutes to or from a given site. I established this core sample during my first 2 visits to Alsace in the summer of 2018 and the following October. During my 3rd and final visit, I returned on a Chateaubriand fellowship to complete my research under my base to include wineries outside of that core sample, shown on the map, which I mainly. Finally, I was also fortunate to be in Alsace and attend wine fairs in both Colmar and Strasbourg, where I got to meet even more wine growers. Generally speaking, many vineyards are established on the flatter plains of Alsace. Most of the more well-renowned ones grow on the hills of the Vosges Mountains. The inclines help to drain water and provide cooler growing environments, with the sheer diversity of 800 different soil types lending themselves to the diversity of tastes in the wines. I more fully describe the settings of my research in my first article, Variability and Change, which was published in a special issue of Anthropology of Food. It was in this article that I outlined my major theoretical focus and understanding of terroir as it relates to a site like terroir is a multi-generational in Ohio where terroir is seldom discussed. Now, before I say terroir one more time, it may be helpful to know what I mean by it. Terroir is most often referred to in the wine world, though it has been applied to cheese, chocolate, coffee, and other artisanal goods. And framed within a geological sense, it means that the natural environment is contributing to the distinctive taste of products coming from a given place. As one of my formants also suggested, it's the idea of climate. It's not just the environment that is contributing to how or should taste, or even how a Riesling from Alsace tastes unique or different to one from Northern. It interacts with humans that help signify place. It's the local know-how, as well as the local regional, national, or even in production and consumption. I'll talk about the importance of terroir of authenticity, and with that, the idea of understood, capital Q, and in quotes, quality, based on provenance. We can't call champagne champagne if it's not grown with specific grapes and processed in the Champenoise style in the region of Champagne. In short, champagne is linked to a certain place, to a certain space, and processes rooted in that place. Jean-Vieux Thiel notes, though, that there's no stable list of factors that define terroir, which can be problematic for the scientific-minded in particular. And yet, it is nevertheless a very real and objective phenomenon for those who ascribe to it, including but not limited to Alsatian wine growers who have grown up with it and of which it is part of their social being or way of life. Finally, as Tim Unwin and others note, terroir is kind of a multivocal term. It means something different to different people. And so being able to explain this complexity over time becomes important. Take a look at the photo on the left that I took at a wine salon in Strasbourg versus the one from a tasting in Bergheim. Note the visual cue of rocks that guests are encouraged to touch and even smell. I'm not so sure of their salinity, but the point here is that the rocks given space are very much linked to the symbolic idea of place, with the terroir having been necessarily imbued into the wine being tasted. When wine other, an argument would be that it's because of these rocks and their environment that there are specific expressions of place alongside the artisanal practices of the wine grower. Now take a look at the right-hand photo of this space occupied by wine growers. Facing me was the vineyard of an informal life of allowed to continue growing. Doing so helps retain moisture in this otherwise. In the left-hand photo, you'll see some soil he picked up from a neighboring vineyard, which is not having been tilled. It's compact and there's no aeration for the roots, which will affect reproduction. Compared from the perspective of varietal originating from the same geopolitical space, we can expect differences in taste and how place-based conditions become exploited or infused into the wine itself because of the wine grower's influence. Importantly, one of the facets of understanding changes in wine growers' landscapes that I emphasize in my fall is the time depth component in relation to weather and climate. Among most of whom I worked with in Central Ohio, what better registers is a sense of climate variability, so the relative lack of time with observing terroir on a daily basis, as is the case in France where climate change has been observed. Regardless of who or what is causing it, wine growers in both regions are recognizing that things are changing. Now, despite the fact that Central Ohioans don't typically refer to terroir, I argue that they are practicing what Heather Paxton calls reverse engineering. Rather than a concern for exploiting nuances and qualities and taste, what is instead embedded in their wines is an ongoing adaptability to constantly changing conditions. Like their French counterparts, Central Ohio wine growers are creating a sense of wines and social engagements. To try and understand the social and ecological dynamics at play in the midst of changing conditions, I turn to what is known as social ecological systems thinking, considering various approaches that illustrate how different components of the systems are interlinked. In addition, I refer to the closed social ecological systems framework proposed by Eleanor Ostrom, the coupled human and natural systems by Zhengyu Liu and colleagues, Millennium Ecosystems Assessments, arguably anthropocentric ecosystem services framework. I'd be more than happy to discuss and compare these in further detail, but for the sake of time, I'll fast forward and say that while these certainly offer different ways of actions, they largely appear to be missing the sensory perceptions of space making that occurs when defining place. That is, how can we better understand how individuals, their passions, decisions, processes, as places change or are even being adapted to create a sense of stability? How might we more meaningfully connect and explain human and more than human relationships as they pertain to place and placemaking? All of this is to say that my dissertation aims to scaffold terroir as its own conceptual framework, understanding the creation or recreation of place as perceived through the senses. This unsurprisingly requires an engagement with the senses, that is sight, touch, sound, taste, smell, and as Clifford Geertz noted among the Javanese, feeling. Here, I am not talking about research on the senses themselves, but rather how what is sensed becomes the form of data to be later analyzed. As a quick example, on the screen are four different cuttings that I made during spring pruning. I framed the various colorations as signals or visual sensory stimuli that help me to understand whether that part of the vine is dead. As you can see, the brown indicates a dead part of the vine, whereas the greener portion indicates that it's alive. Haptic cues include the rigidity or flexibility of the branches, while the sound of clippers cutting through the wood itself are oral cues. To present or analyze the sensory intakes and results in activities is to consider Tom Jackson's novel helical multisensory framework that he developed for his own dissertation. According to the model, we can begin with a progression of the sensory stimuli produced by an actor, or in actor network theory terms, an actant, which includes both human and non-human entities. Before it is received, a given stimulus first becomes transformed within the environment in which the stimulus was produced. So, for example, the sound of metal on wood might sound different in the space while someone is cooking versus outdoors, even while working in the vineyard. The transformed stimulus is then received by what Jackson refers to as a sentient being, that is, another actant, and is subsequently interpreted, both processes of which he notes are culturally informed and influenced by what Vanini and others identify as intensity, context, and moral or aesthetic character. Finally, the actant responds in some way to that cue. In my previous example, the sensory cues and time depth of past knowledge provide information for deciding whether that branch is viable and should be used as a cordon. This attention to the senses served as the basis for my second article, which was published in Practicing Anthropology. As I explained more fully in this article, interviews and participant observations comprised my core ethnographic method, which produced the bulk of my sensory data. The first type of interview I began with was a walking interview. The sort of grand tour allowed me to better understand wine growers' relationships with the environment as they revealed which landscape features were inherently sensed as most important by virtue of what they pointed out. These were then followed up by semi-directed interviews that discussed such topics as wine growers' previous experiences, typical regional patterns, perspectives of science and scientific research, and what had changed following field season. What you should hear here are footsteps on the Alsatian terrain. Due to my back and forth returns to Central Ohio and Alsace, I was able to more or less create parallel timelines, if only artificially, in both regions, where I was subsequently able to compare pruning, harvesting, and bottling techniques. Through these forms of participant observation, I was to get a better sense of Weingart's in-place embodied experiences. Moreover, I want to emphasize the data collected beyond direct observations in the field, with the understanding that sensory experiences data that informed embodied experiences in situ and in relation to place. As I shared, I collected haptic data from pruning and participant observations. I gleaned auditory data from interview recordings and background noise, such as buzzing insects, bird calls, nearby or further away cars, or as you can hear here, the sounds of yeast fermenting grape juice. Finally, I could never imagine this project without actually participating in wine tastings and tasting the wines, through which I transcribed olfactory and gustatory data from trying grapes in the vineyard and wines in the wine cellar or tasting room. In this first image, we were given masks to blind our visual cues, which enhance our other senses. And in this image, I enjoyed wines alongside dishes that the wine grower had prepared for me. I would like to mention that data verification was important as I conducted my research and wrote up my articles. In addition to vocal checks to ensure that I was understanding what informants were telling me in the moment, I also checked for perceived accuracy and reactions to their comments by sharing manuscript excerpts with them. I achieved further triangulation of multiple data sets, inclusive of photos taken, news stories, and Facebook posts, through in-person follow-ups that included reviewing wines and photo elicitation and review, as well as ongoing text and Facebook messages with them. In doing so, and hopefully my informants agree, to build trust and collaboration while concurrently working to ensure that Persandra Matheson can the most realistic pictures of reality. In addition to outlining the methodological approach I've done here, my second article explores how my research enabled me to focus on how I interpreted the sensory world around me. I describe the dormancy and waking up of the vines at the start of the vine cycle, differences in walking on dry soils in Alsace and damp ones in central Ohio, and the cues wine growers go by to describe whether a given vintage is good or not. At its core, I argue that an attention to the senses is necessary to understand perceptions and responses to change, climatic or otherwise. One aspect that I've not yet brought up are the actors who participate in the wine growing system and who produce and consume sensory stimuli. To that end, I'm happy to share the images of the human informants who contributed to my work and without whom I would not have been able to conduct my research. Heard here are some of their collective voices in both English and French.
Yeah, we haven't been up to Geneva.
I know we have very late-rich soil.
It's high-quality wine. The bigger we get, the less I'm able to ensure that. And there's a lot of stuff I want. If I can figure it out, I'm going to make it. I'm going to learn to, I guess, how
to bring this supposed to be. As you can see, I interacted with more than 24 wine growers, as well as members of their families, friends, co-workers, and volunteers, representing 19 different sites. I spent countless hours with them throughout the totality of my research period, and so I wanted to take this moment to recognize them and thank them again for their participation. By and large, the wine growers I worked with oversee a state-level production and are typically part of family-run businesses. For those in Alsace, wine growing has been a decades-long, if not multi-generational, endeavor, whereas a few in central Ohio have been growing grapes and making wine for 20 to 30 years, while most of them have turned their interests or hobby in wine growing for the past 10 years or so. And so in addition to growing to different growing environments, the wine growers in both regions are working with different varietals and time depths of knowledge when it comes to wine growing and becoming attuned to changing conditions. Moreover, I take a multi-species position that humans were not my only informants, as more than human informants tell wine growers and me as the researcher something. As I argue in my third article, which is currently under a resubmitted review in Culture, Agriculture, Food, and species other than humans have a role in fine wine production, whereby their contributions are not merely physical, but also affective and material forms of labor. Pictured here is a sample of informants that I also learned from, birds, insects, and various parts of the vine. I've inherently preferenced the human informants in my work because I could understand them, but I do make the case in my article that more than human informants offer important data. For example, the presence, the lack thereof of birds, we speak to changing migratory patterns and the extent to which insects are an added pressure. In the second image of the we can see a triangular piercing made by a bird in search for ripened seeds, which signals the point when wine growers must soon decide whether or not to net or harvest. As the season progresses, the grape juices naturally begin to ferment, indicating the presence of natural yeast and becoming the bees. And as another example, the specific patterning and coloration on these leaves signals the plant, specifically at the hand of a wood disease known as Lisca, Other species are telling us different things, or at least their actions may be interpreted as such, by needing to pay attention to them as part of the wider wine-growing system as we seek to understand Tihuar and the taste of place. In various ways, more than human entities are workers, as they not only help control pests or convert sugars into wines, but through their responsive behaviors, which signal or inform wine growers of what should be done. I thus question my article what remuneration looks like for more than human workers who participate, forcibly or accidentally, in the production of wine. Drawing on Jackson's model, as well as Bruno Latour's conceptualization of actor network theory, as I noted a few minutes ago, I define both human and more than human participants of the wine growing system as actants, the terroir concept of which, I argue, emerges from the sensory relationships that connect them. Terroir is not just about nuances and the qualities that are embedded, but the totality of sensory linkages among all of them. The range of these components are therefore part and parcel of what makes terroir a complex system, or as Daryl Cressman calls, whatever's being analyzed, a black box of subsystems. And so if terroir or even the taste of place is that system, we can deconstruct the various systems that are somehow related to it and to each other. Terroir is not just about sun, rain, and wind, but also the influence of wildlife and the human social processes, as well as what may appear as external pressures like climate change and COVID that are in play and situated within this closed system. All of this has some bearing on the emergent property of terroir. I get into these relationships in the fourth and final article included in my dissertation, which is still in review in Social Anthropology, Anthropologie Sociale, both human and more than human species as mediators or active agents of terroir expression. As wine growers are able to articulate terroir in the taste of place, I argue that the vines are producing grapes that get turned into wine. Given this role, they, like wine growers, produce unpredictable characteristics in the face of change. Returning then to my initial questions, which I most fully respond to in my fourth article, there are a wide range of such vitivinicultural. We can, for example, the family members, workers, and volunteers who help out from time to time, the lawmakers and committees that successful place-based labeling, researchers across different fields and domains, as well as various forms of wildlife and microbes, and even post and trellis wires that can signal age and previous harvest densities. The wine growers of my study perceive change over time, comparing the present to their own past experiences. These include, on the social side, earlier harvest dates and processes, the use of automated equipment, and shifting economic challenges driven by consumer demands and export regulations. On the ecological front, Ohio is generally dealing with colder temperatures and more humidity, while Alsace is experiencing hotter temperatures and more instances of drought. Depending on the place, some wine growers are experiencing high yields but lower quality, but the same if not better quality than years past. Riesling continues to have issues with water for 2 years. Wine growers shared a wide range of responses to observed changes, or as I see it, the various sensory stimuli that they interpret, which I have listed on the screen. Some of these include adding things to pressed grape juice, such as permitted tartaric acid in Alsace, or experimenting with different pectin enzymes in Central Ohio, making choices regarding biodynamic practices or various spray programs and frequencies, or altering the landscape, as in the case of planting trees to promote shade, or deciding whether to net grapes prior to harvest. Due to various legislative constraints, some practices are easier than others to implement, leading Central Ohio opportunity to plant new varietals, which as long as they're planted in Ohio soil are still Ohioan, versus those in Alsace who can experiment, but are doing so at the expense of labeling restrictions that name which varietals can be then cultivated. With all that said, I'd like to share my own conceptualization of terroir in terms of its goût or its taste. On the left, I maintain dichotomies among living and non-living actants for both categorical, so as not to erase ongoing discriminations against humans. Rather than being connected by lines and arrows, I've placed them in boxes with dotted lines that suggest a flow of relationships between and among them. All of these respond to the sensory stimuli I've listed on the right-hand side of the schematic, but also the various forces that affect both culture and vitiviniculture. This includes climate, various regulations, and the local and global markets. All of these components feed into the identity of the participants, both people and non-human entities, the products, and the places that emerge from actants' interactions. Again, terroir is both a dynamic social and ecological system, of which my framework illustrates processes and flows of change throughout. Taken on the whole, I argue that both Central Ohioan and Alsatian wine growing identity is linked in part to varietal and what wine growers grow and produce, location and where they have chosen to grow grapes and produce wine, and tradition and the processes over time that yield as consistent results, whether that be in terms of taste, expression, or feeling. Clearly, everything is linked, with one change influencing the rest of the system to various degrees. And because this complex and has many subsystems that can change, there are many opportunities to introduce innovations. The big problem is not knowing whether it is too late to introduce them. That is, there is an overall sense that it is necessary to adapt, but how and when should one act? Drawing upon actor network theory, as I do in my dissertation, allows us to understand the relationships among actors and pinpoint areas where things may change. Finally, and perhaps most importantly, these relationships are sensorially based, and understanding these perceptions of various stimuli is important to understanding the network. Studying terroir and the taste of place, the multisensory and multispecies approaches allows for an analysis of changes in the identity of wine growers and other actants and the products being produced during periods of. Before formally conclude, I do want to briefly mention that I discussed in my dissertation a series of possible future directions from research. This includes building upon ongoing work following the INRA's long-term adaptation to climate change and viticulture and enology program, learning more about the vision of terroir currently being crafted by the younger wine growers, understanding the past and ongoing effects of COVID-19 on vineyards and wineries, and even the future of Pinot Noir and its growing production in the face of climatic and other forms of change. And with that, I'll conclude by saying that I'm indebted to so many, including but not limited to my committee members, family, friends, funders, and especially the wine growers themselves for their various forms of support, some of whom are here today. And after all my prior prompting, it turns out that we do have some time, so I'd like to open virtual space to any questions, comments, or even critiques. Thanks for your attention. All right, so I think I have unmuted all and given you the ability to unmute yourselves, but I see Gray has a question. Or if anyone does, you can just unmute yourselves and ask.
Sorry, I have a comment, kind of a question. So when you're talking about the eye covering to help with the sensory with the wine tasting, I would question whether it enhances your other senses or whether it allows you to focus on particular senses, especially since in health and disability studies, that is considered not accurate of blind people's perspectives. Does that make sense?
Yeah, certainly. I think in referencing that, I was referencing Christina Ha, who was a winner from MasterChef season 3 or something. And she's a blind cook. And I thought that was a term she had used. And so I think you're right, definitely in terms of focusing on something else when you're removing that aspect, relatively speaking, for me, at least, as someone who can't see, it registered as something as enhancing, but focusing definitely makes sense as well. Richard?
Hi, Mark. Really great presentation. Really loved it. I just have a question for you about the More Than Humor framework, which I'm sure is probably not surprising for me to ask a question about. I'm really love this framework, and I'm glad that you applied it to the dissertation. I had a question about the extent to which you might have considered alcohol as an actant within this, because I use chemoethnographic theory as a More Than Human framework. And so I'm interested in what extent the alcohol itself plays a role as an actant within this process. If you could maybe speak a little bit to that. I apologize, my cat apparently has something to say as well.
No, that's fine. Yeah, so for me, I have it's the human actants, the non-human actants, and then the non-living. So for me, the trellis wine, like I was saying, that in itself is an actant in the system. So just as well, I would say the alcohol is itself an actant that's produced from the combination of the yeast and the sugars and the grape over time. And so I would say that the presence of the alcohol, at least for the bees itself, it becomes this thing that the bees are drawn to and that they're taking in. Unless you're talking about the alcohol in relation to the humans, in which case humans are responding to that actin and that stimulus also.
Hey, Mark Anthony, I have a question.
Sure.
Yeah, first of all, thank you very much for the presentation. You've done a lot of work. It's really an awesome dissertation. you've done. I can't wait to continue reading the articles. I had a question for you about the Tehua question. Could you talk maybe more about some of the AOC and EU regulations compared to the AVA in the United States, American viticultural areas, and the ways in which these regulations, these policies and so on also affect, you know, in a comparative way, constructions of terroir?
Yeah, for sure. So the AOC regulations in France, at least, they're much more rigid. And so in Alsace, there are 7 white varietals that are accepted that you can grow and you turn into wine and you call that Alsatian wine. And so Gewurztraminer Riesling are one of those, or 2 of those 7. And so this question that I have then is, well, what if you don't have that? What does that mean for Alsatian wine growing? By contrast, here in Ohio, we, at least Central Ohio, there is no AVA that's here. I know one or two of the wine growers I work with are interested in that. We have 5 other AVAs around Central Ohio, but we don't have that kind of continuity to establish that right now. And so from my understanding, I think it's if you plant, you have to plant at least 80 to 90% of the grapes, whatever grape it is, on Ohio soil, you call that Ohio. There's no regulation as to varietal or anything like that. And so this comparative perspective here is one in which it's very regulated in Alsace and one where it's not as regulated. But I would say that those things are starting to change as well. It's also interesting for Alsace in part because compared to the rest of the country, that focuses on varietal, or that is based on territory and the naming system. In Alsace, that naming is based on varietal itself. And so that transition is also starting to change what those rules mean. All right, unfortunately, I think I have to cut it off there. Thank you all for attending this presentation. Again, I'll be recording or pushing this recording later. So thank you for joining, and I'll hope to talk to you all soon.